60 Minutes with Angela starts right now.
And so it was that on Wednesday, November 11, 2015, Nigerians came to know what ministries President Muhammadu Buhari's nominees will be supervising. The 36 men and women, all selected by the president according to the dictates of Nigeria's constitution in section 147, subsection 3. We now know that there will be apparently 25 ministries, reduced from 32 that his predecessor, President Goodluck Jonathan, had used. And we also know that the Ahmed Joda Transition Committee, instituted by President Buhari, had recommended a merger of all ministries into the tidy sum of 19. Well, the president says he has fulfilled the principle of federal character as espoused in the Constitution. Is this Nigeria's dream team? Well, hello and welcome. This is 60 Minutes with me, Angela Ajitumobi. Thank you for joining me on the program today. As the president inaugurates his cabinet of 36 ministers, we'll also be focusing our attention on four men. We like to call them the alumni of 60 Minutes with Angela. These four men: the former governor of Ekiti State, Dr. Kayode Fayemi, former national publicity secretary of the All Progressives Congress, Lai Mohammed, former governor of Lagos State, Babatunde Fashola, senior advocate of Nigeria, SAN, and former governor of Rivers State, Rotimi Chibuike Amaechi. Before Nigerians were wowed by them at the screening by the Senate, we had been having regular conversations with them between 2011 and 2014. Well, that's where my host today comes in, a syndicated journalist and public policy analyst. Together, we'll be looking at the ministerial list, their portfolios, and the challenges ahead. Join me after the break as I count down 60 minutes with Joe Agbro, a syndicated journalist and public policy analyst. Welcome back. Welcome, Mr. Agbro. Thank you very much for coming back on the program.
I'm glad to be here.
I thought we'll start with the tribunals. In Rivers State, Governor Nyesom Wike has been removed as governor, although he's appealing that decision. In addition to that, 20 out of 32 House of Assembly members also had their election annulled at the same time. You know, the PDP through Governor Wike are all saying this is a witch hunt. Governor Wike says it's targeted at him. So do you think it is possible that the security agencies and the courts are skewing judgments in favor of the APC?
Well, it's possible and it's as well not possible because these are decisions of the tribunal,
yes.
Temple of Justice. So we want to assume they're following the laws of the land.
Yes.
It's just that a few things are curious.
Such as?
Such like, why remove the tribunal sitting from Port Harcourt to Abuja?
Well, they said they cited security concerns.
But the election will still hold the Port Yoruba State. Will still hold there. As a matter of fact, that was a contentious issue they raised earlier on, but I think that has been laid to rest. Mm. Maybe at a higher level, they may revisit it.
Yes.
But granted that the tribunal were right, from the one, even before the election, crises have rocked River State. Its security had been everywhere. Life had been very unsafe. So it is not too surprising. But the Wike's legal team are saying that the tribunal relied more on the evidence of Those who were not at the voting point, and at the evidence of those at the voting point, were discountenanced. I don't know what premium of weight will be placed on that at the appellate court. But for now, that is the judgment. And unless you want to go against the loss of the land, you can protest. But there are good grounds to appeal.
Yes. You know, people are citing other states, like Delta State, for instance, where the PDP have been declared as the true winners, you know, by the tribunals. So it can't be true, really, that it looks as if the judiciary is just acting in favor of the APC, can it?
Right. They say it is how you present your case before the law court, that the judge will not manufacture evidence for you, that at his disposal that it will adjudicate upon. So it's curious, though, but people want to say that, well, because River State, the APC had always wanted it all along.
And with the movement of Governor Amechi to the APC.
Yes, and Amechi really put his life on the line to ensure that APC had it, but did not come out through the first ballot.
Yes.
So I don't think we should lose sleep over that. They're going for a re-election. What one can converse at this material time is that the rerun should be free and fair, to be seen by all to be so. The shenanigans of the security agencies that were said or alleged to have played some dubious role should now be checkmated at this time, so that the will of the people can really come to the surface. But this question of doubting here, doubting there, does not help anybody. I'm sure even if we can get re-elected again, we will be on a firmer ground to say that, yes, I'm here by the virtue of the people's mandate.
Yes.
But it's not giving up from what I gather. He has an appeal. And if otherwise he lost, he will not know that well. The people did not want him at the initial, but the process must be transparent, must be seen to be free and fair, and everybody must maintain his boundaries, vis-a-vis the electoral officers, the security officers, and all that are concerned with the conduct of the election.
Okay. So let's move on to Bayelsa State. Do you think Governor Dixon will break that jinx? Or will it be a return of Governor Timi Presilva?
Allow me to say that I was there before, was voted for a second term.
Yes.
So
there's no jinx.
But I see a keen contest.
Between who?
Between Governor Dixon and former Governor Silva in the Bayelsa State. But for now, I think the odds are in favor of Dixon.
Why do you say so?
If you monitor the media correctly, there have been movement from one party to the other. And if you also know that the primaries that brought out former Governor Silva, it was not tidy. His major opponent in that primary was Timi Alaide. And from what I gather from the papers, all his supporters have moved back to PDP. Don't forget, until the presidential election, Timi Alaide was in PDP. He only crossed back to contest for governorship under APC. Because he knows that if he remains in PDP,
he won't get it.
So you can see the situation, there's fluid movement here and up and down.
But we also have reports of people moving from PDP to APC.
Yes, I'm talking of preponderance.
Yes.
Especially after the primaries that produced Silva.
People who were dissatisfied.
And they are quite legion. For example, the deputy publicity secretary of APC, Timi Frank.
Yes,
he's not happy. In fact, his grounds went beyond that. Silva came to be the candidate, but that since he was made the candidate of the party, he has not reached out to many people, including himself.
Yes,
maybe that could be a part of ego. I don't know. But when you make such statements in the public domain, it affects some fence sitters to know where to align with, and this is not happening very close to the elections. So movements at this time are quite crucial.
Yeah.
If you move right, the tendency that you'll be dissatisfied before election and move back is remote. So on the basis of this calculation that I said, the odds favor Governor Dixon.
What about the factor of the former president, Goodluck Jonathan? You think perhaps that the people of Bayelsa will want to retain Bayelsa as a PDP state, at least to honor him and say, you know, even though he lost as an incumbent, his state remains PDP.
You see, if you will notice, the man has been quiet for some time. In fact, he had not really made any public statement. But the son of that state had occupied the highest position in this country, coming back home and remaining at home. His physical presence in Bayelsa alone sent a very positive message to members of PDP. Does not need to mount any rostrum. And don't forget, it was at the formal launching of the campaign for the Governor Dixon.
Yes.
So that is a factor that we cannot rule out. It will have its own ripple effect. And see, forget about newspaper publicity or electronic publicity. The woman, the average voter at the village level.
Yes, the woman who sells fish.
Yes, he remembers a good Lord Jonathan, their son. For you to get her out of that frame of mind, it's possible though, I'm not saying it's not possible,
yes,
but it's not that easy. Again, Timmy Prince Silver had been a bit charismatic in his measures as a gubernatorial candidate. But is he bringing the people together?
Reconciling?
I think not. But if he has been doing that and is successful, then we'll give a good fight. Otherwise, oh sure.
What factors do you think will come to play in Kogi State? Because these are the two states where we're having elections shortly.
Kogi could be very close in the sense that if you flash back to the last election, particularly the federal election, they lost some key positions. Some say Governor Wada had performed well. Some others say not. Former Governor Aldo, in fact, the similarity between Bayelsa and Kogi are quite close here. Except that there have been a lot of time gap between since Aldo left the scene and the EFCC case hanging over his neck. So these are his minuses. Otherwise, he's an ebullient politician.
They say he's a grassroots man.
Yes, when he moves, when he talks. If you met him one-on-one, you will know that he's a grassroots man. And his presence is very efficient. He captivates people.
Mm.
Yes. Unlike Wada, who is not as charming.
Or charismatic.
As Aldo. You can't miss Aldo's presence in any gathering. You can't. He's there. He's like Bakizu of Kano State.
Yes, he rouses the people.
Yes, curiosity for whatever it is. He rouses curiosity. If he's in the one restaurant in the hotel in Abuja, everybody around will know that. Who is this person? Oh, who is this?
Did you read any meaning into the fact that the president was absent at the formal kickoff of the former Governor Aldo's campaign?
No. The reason is this. If you observed the president very closely, he's a man who is not generous with his presence. So it does not matter whether he likes something or he hates something. Sometimes he appears to be too strict for his office. That is, he does not give us himself to the people, either to the party or even to the ordinary people. That's an occasion for him to really showcase himself before the people. Not for
socially.
People. Socially.
Yes.
And politically too. Expose himself. Let's see the man. Because the last time they saw him was when he went there for campaign. They've never had a close contact with him ever since. So, but those who have followed his movement will know that. It's not that he supports it. He said that he supports his candidature. And the vice president is making up for that. I don't think it's a minus for former Governor Aldo. As a matter of fact, the odds favor him because geographically, Kogi is very close to Abuja. And all the influences and powers flow from Abuja.
Yes.
So Kogi is down south, is the first recipient of those benevolences, we call them. So you can easily tap on that, join that loop. Yes.
And I suppose congratulations are in order to the people of Taraba State. Shockingly, the first female governor has come from the north, contrary to what many people thought. She's a woman of many firsts, the first female attorney general in Taraba State, the former senator as well, now a minister. So, you know, what was your reaction to that announcement by the Taraba State Election Petitions Tribunal?
Very positive. But it's not in any way conclusive. But the information came to me, somebody just said, congratulations, the first female governor. I said, who? Then I was told of the outcome of the verdict. Then I replied that she's not the first female governor, even though by election.
By election, yes.
Because in Anambra, there have been the governor.
Vejie Tiaba,
who came in as a replacement for Peter Obi at the time. Let's congratulate her for her various firsts. But for this one, it's not yet hallelujah. We can't sing hallelujah chorus now. Because firstly, the incumbent has gone on appeal, or will go on appeal. And in the interim, he remains the governor throughout the pendency of the appeal. And when you know matters get to this level,
yes,
all the legal giants
will be called upon.
Yeah, they are there to tell us.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, some they help you to understand the case better. Others confuse you more. So as it is now,
yes,
while she has hooves, it is not yet to hoof. It will be from my household. They are happy. I want to have a first female governor by election.
Yes.
Through the ballot box.
And you've been following the crises in both houses of the National Assembly. The House of Reps were told two members came to blows, you know, over this chairmanship of committees and the distribution. They're accusing the Speaker, Yakubu Dogara, of being anti-party and working against the President. Those are weighty allegations.
Yes, they are weighty. But I think they are so hollow. They are weighty, they are true. In fact, very, very weighty, they are true. But on a close examination, they are also hollow. Yakubu Dogara, the Honorable Speaker of the House of Reps, is an APC man. He contested under the APC.
Yes.
And he won the election. And his colleagues voted him to be the Speaker. So on that basis, one should accept that he's a loyal party man. But you see, the problems with APC in the National Assembly dated back before the inauguration of the National Assembly. And I would rather say it was a result of leadership failure. The leadership of APC took many things for granted. Firstly, because they had majority in both houses, they think they can do things on their own without wooing other members. They forgot to learn from the lesson of the past speaker,
yes,
the new past speaker of the House of Reps. Number one. Oh, challenge PDP strategy and then, of course, one year from behind. Just what happened in this case.
Yes.
That will have been so recent in everybody's memory, followers of the politics of National Assembly. They should have been more circumspect the way they threw out their preferred candidate. Nothing wrong, having preferred candidates, but there have to be plenty, sufficient legwork. First, to realize that you are not an island on your own, especially in the Senate. The gap is 10 senators, and this can be bridged by anybody. Mm-hmm. And if the whole PDP stick together, and if you break away from APC,
there will always be danger.
The whole equation will be upturned. Ditto for the House of Rep, even though the margin House of Rep is a bit tolerable.
Yes.
So, in trying to choose preferred candidates, they went too public before television cameras, come and vote. In open election, of course, the losers will not take it easy. They will go behind and sabotage what the person has done. Don't forget, the National Assembly members are not house boys to everybody. They contested the election and won. So it's not a question you sit in the comfy of your one office and say, do this, do this, do this.
Yes.
It does not work.
That's
you are, in theory, we talk of party supremacy, but in practice, there's a lot of work to do to where to have a cohesive body. People keep talking about Awolowo's party discipline. They also talk about the amount of work he put in to achieve that cohesion. If you are not cohesive at all, you cannot present a united front in the open, which they did not achieve. And because they failed to achieve it, that problem is there and has gotten to a level that it is difficult to solve. It's now become intractable. And the members involved are not people you can throw away easily. What discipline will you matter to the Senate President? To Dogara. These are people with substantial following in their various houses. So any negative thing affecting one will flow down the line and the schism will continue. So instead of solving the problem, you are aggravating it. As they would say, like, poor. So it is there. The problem has there come to stay. They have to handle it softly. But coming to blows in the House of Reps is very unfortunate. It shows that sometimes the anger exhibited by those who feel that Dogara had performed poorly in the distribution, the level of anger is not justified. I say this, no outsider has come to take a position in the House of Reps. All the members given chairmanship position won their election. They are there as of right representing their people. So if APC man is right to be there, the other person is also right to be there. Maybe what they should have quarreled with which they have will have done behind. Most of this should not be in the open. Because once you bring a matter into the open, the solution becomes more difficult.
Yes.
But if said the president had not maintained the level of aloofness he maintained. Yes. And invited these people one after the other, saying, look, we are in this party together.
Stop this public display.
Yes. Use his moral force to wear people to. It would have been a lot easier. But if this one is making statements, especially when the rumor peddled around is right that this court is being sponsored from outside the National Assembly.
Yes.
People are right to feel embittered. The NPC are justified to say that they deserve more than the 48 they got.
Chairmanship.
Position. Yes. And they are also jealous that the 46 of PDP is a bit too close for their own comfort. It's their own right. They are free to. But the anger should not overflow to the level that they are looking like uncultured children.
Join us again after the break.
It is difficult to respond to that question.
Angela, that's a great question.
Great question, Angela.
Angela, that is a very great question.
That's a great question.
Okay, that's a great question.
Yeah, very good question.
That's a good question.
This is an interesting question you put.
60 Minutes with Angela. Again, answers to every question you always wanted to ask.
Welcome back. If you've just joined us, it's 60 Minutes with me, Angela Ajitumobi, on my hot seat today, Joe Agbro, a syndicated journalist and public policy analyst. I was reading Senior Advocate of Nigeria, Femi Falana. He advised the Senate President to stop attending the Code of Conduct Tribunal with all senators, saying that wasn't solidarity. But the senators, you know, they had previously said they will continue to accompany the Senate President to the tribunal because they consider it to be persecution, not prosecution. The facts upon which these charges were based on issues or events that happened over 12 years ago. Do you agree with them?
To begin with, I don't think it will be in order and good manner for the Senate President to tell his colleagues, don't come with me. He did not ask them to come.
Yes, but you see, they shut down the Senate.
Yeah.
Every time they're going to attend.
Yeah, you see, do you think he has the power to say,
don't come?
He doesn't. His powers end in the Senate.
They decide they are following him. Yes. What can he do?
Nothing. That's what I say. See, sometimes people want to be sanctimonious. They want to feel that they have a lot of morality to exhibit. I say, tell them not to come. You see, for God's sake, senators are not small boys anywhere in the world.
Yes.
They are not there to be dictated to. For example, if a senator refuses to attend a plenary session and he does not fulfill the number of attendance required, you won't go and flog him. You can't listen. You are bad.
Yes.
So they have a choice to do what they want to do. That's in reply to the senior advocate, Femi Falana.
Yes.
Now, it's a matter of perception, opinion, whichever side of the divide you belong, to say that what is happening is persecution and not prosecution. It's a bit curious, though, that one would have asked, if Senator Bukola Saraki had not become the Senate President, would this matter have been resurrected from wherever it was?
Does it matter?
Does it really matter? So, from that angle, people say, yes, he's been persecuted because he defied the order of his political party, which fortunately is government in power today. That's one. Two, this events took place years back. He seems to be a governor about how many years ago?
Yes.
Long time ago. The matters are just coming to the surface now. And there are many arguments on both sides. One has said that, if you notice errors in my form, did you draw my attention to it for clarification?
The law says you give him a chance,
yes,
to come forward, yes, and deny or update or accept.
Yes. He was not given the chance. So if you examine this, if you look at it from this angle, it is straightforward persecution because he defied his party. If I alleged that somebody outside,
yes,
went and unearthed these things and said, look, I will fight you to finish. No way. Code of conduct, make use of this. It's neither here nor there, but it's not in the domain of the judiciary.
Yes.
Let's see how they trash it out.
Some people think he shouldn't continue to make attempts to stop the tribunal. They think stopping the tribunal now, you know, it will still leave a sour taste in the mouth, because it would mean we never established whether he was guilty or innocent.
Yes. You see, we can't be right all the time. And many times, whatever we do, we always leave some kind of taste in the mouth. In trying to stop it, he has not gone outside the law. He's pursuing it through the courts. And if the courts, the higher courts, say he is justified, that he has a case against the tribunal to stop it, doesn't matter whose mouth is soured, but we are not fouling the legal system.
Yes.
Let the legal system continue.
And that MTN fine,
yes,
$5.2 billion,
yeah.
Senator Ben Bruce expressed an opinion that he thought it was an overkill and it would negatively influence potential investors who had intentions of coming into the country. Was the infraction committed or not? And if it was, why are we saying they shouldn't pay the fine, or the fine should be reviewed downwards?
With due respect to Senator Ben Bruce, I think MTN should pay the fine. This is deliberate. You failed or refused to disconnect people whose registrations were incomplete.
Mm-hmm.
These are the extant laws.
Of the country.
Of the country. They are extant. They are not just policy introduced by one, but they are not. They are there. So your actions were deliberate. Maybe they thought because they are so massive in the telecom industry, you could do many things and go away with it. I think we have to start somewhere by applying our laws. It may not be comfortable for some people at a given point in time, but certainly we should form a tradition of it, become our culture.
Yes. And strong institutions.
Yes, strong institutions that can enforce laws. As a matter of all the problems we are crying about, we have the laws, but the institutions are weak. But if for once this one is out to enforce some discipline,
yes,
some sanitization of the system, of course, I support it. It's not punitive, even though the amount is massive,
yes.
I know, but they benefited, right?
Yes.
Illegally.
And you know, the NCC actually gave a 7-day ultimatum to all the telecom companies to regularize these things. And they said they have evidence to show that the other telcos were doing it, either disconnecting or making sure that the registrations were complete. But MTN made no move whatsoever.
That is it. All along they were benefiting. I'm aware that they did that because I called a few friends from other networks to say this number does not, the number I used to,
yes,
yeah, because we were disconnected. About a week or so after, the same number that they took was, because that person, subscriber, has regularized
his registration.
Registration.
Yes.
Yeah. So you cannot eat your cake and have it, for God's sake. Along the line, you have to be disciplined. It's massive. I was hearing somewhere that the banks cannot even sponsor or support or back up that fine.
Yes.
But they should find a way around it. Or meanwhile, we nationalize their assets.
But they were making monies on those numbers that were not registered.
Yes. And they were signatory to it. We are the principal signatory to it. So leniency, I think no. But pay, they must pay. So that others can learn their lessons. That yes, in Nigeria,
yes,
at least change has come. So let's do things the proper way.
And the president has promised to fulfill his promises to the Golden Eaglets, made in 1985, 30 years ago, when they first won the Under-17 World Cup. You know, who sent them to a reception then,
yeah,
in Dodan Barracks,
yes,
in Lagos here. And were you surprised that the Eaglets had never received the pledges and promises, the gifts they were promised?
Why did he not give the
gifts? Well, you know, he didn't last in office, President Buhari.
I remember. But it's a good thing. Government is a continuum. Once a government made an undertaking, it doesn't,
yes,
matter which president entered into the undertaking. Any other president can redeem it.
Mm.
It's in the normal manner of doing things. It's following due process. So if he does it, well, I congratulate him.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, he should find himself lucky that within months of ascending the number one position, political position in Nigeria, an international trophy is being delivered for him to caress.
Yes.
So,
and we won the Scrabble World Championship.
Yes,
as
he should
well
find himself lucky. As a matter of fact, he should do much more than what was promised in 1985.
All right, so let's look at the ministerial list now, the nominees. I wanted us to start with the recommendations of the Georgia Transition Committee. They had recommended the scrapping of ministries, departments, and agencies not covered by law. And I thought, how can any of these MDAs be operating if they're not covered by law? You know, what would be the grounds for them operating?
Government. I mean government.
Yes.
Federal, state, local government. The originator of the word impunity. A military governor once woke up and wrote the name of a company. Just the name, like, so limited.
Yes.
And the following day, from his death, the following day, opened a bank account for it. No registration of whatever. Can you do that? What government can do it?
No memo and articles of association. And
anyway, that was during the military. Mm. But even now, if they set up an agency,
yes,
what are you going to question? The moment they set it up, they send the bill to National Assembly. Maybe it will take 3 years there. In the meantime, the agency is already operating. Sometimes National Assembly might go forget it there, from one senior to the other one.
Yes.
And it's forgotten until somebody wakes up to see that, where's the registration for this agency? So it's not too surprising. Mm-hmm. And I'm a judge, he's a veteran of the civil service. During Shagari's time, I was the chairman of the transition committee. Fortunately, I was a small boy who served in that committee as special assistant.
Wow.
So I knew him one-on-one.
Yes.
He's a veteran. When you call people super pamps, you belong to one of them. And you know this. Civil service, inside our day, is pamp. The Pasiodo, the late Ibrahim Tamshida.
Yes.
And whole lot of them, they know the civil service. And none of them were in that committee. So if he said so,
he must know what he's saying.
I want to believe he knows what he's saying very well, too.
Do you support the reduction of ministries from 32 to 25, even though Jordan had recommended to 19?
Yes. At any point in time, who is taking the decision depends upon how his mind is working. There are certain issues that a Jordan committee may not have adverted its mind to,
yes,
which now came into the fore. There are also other issues that might have arisen out of political consideration. Because everything is not the hard figures will follow. You have to give vent for political consideration. And if those ones came to the fore between the time that Majorda submitted his report and now when decision is taken, there could be good reasons for the addition. And don't forget, Majorda committee is not infallible. So let's give room for all those things.
And we were told that there will be 25 ministries.
Ministry, yes.
We have a few mergers. Works and housing will come together now. Information, culture will also come together with orientation. So we'll talk more on the ministerial list when we come back from this break. So join us again after the break.
It is difficult to respond to that question.
Angela, that's a great question.
Great question, Angela.
Angela, that is a very great question.
That's a great question. Okay, that's a great question.
Yeah, very good question.
That's a good question.
This is an interesting question you put.
60 Minutes with Angela. Again, answers to every question you always wanted to ask.
Welcome back. My concluding moments now with Joe Agbro. Going back to the ministerial retreat held recently by the president, he spoke of a three-point direction. He spoke about the economy, he spoke about security, and the anti-corruption war. A lot of people were disappointed that still no word on political restructuring.
I'm one of those that felt disappointed. Good thing we need to revamp the economy, and there's a lot to be done in that area, especially now that oil prices going down and down. Because if it should go down below this,
yes,
for a short while, we might slide into recession. Corruption is good to plug all the leakages and to rein in all those things that can contribute towards corruption. Where money has been stolen now, we're looking for them, but that's not the way to look for the money. Information about the money laundered can be obtained here. Because the money did not just fly, it was taken out by somebody. In the 7th National Assembly,
yes,
they had about 82 probes in all. House of Rep accounted for 66. I'm talking between 1999 and the life of that one.
Yes.
And recently, Senator Dino Melaye, yes, asking for another probe on the $63 billion Abuja runway.
Abuja Airport.
Airport runway. Yes. So that's a ripoff. Because a similar one of that same category was constructed in Gombe for about 8 billion and Akwaibom about 10 billion or thereabout. Add the two together, it's not only up to half of what is going for Abuja. So all these are scandalous.
Yes.
What I'm saying in essence is that in all these various reports carried out by either the Senate or the House of Rep, the reports are available. And any study of those reports will give a lead as to where our money had gone illegally. Corrupting ways.
Yes.
That is on that area. The important thing is that why did the president include political restructuring? Not that the federal executive will do something directly, because to do that, you need the National Assembly. You see, the report of the 2014 Constitutional Conference is very rich. It contains solutions to most of the problems that afflict us in this country. Is it security, system of government, political restructuring, that is states and all that, devolution of power, revenue sharing formula, religion, up to minute matters like cattle grazing. Cattle grazing. You know, it's not the talking point, but it's fundamental enough that that report contains a solution to it. Again, if you now avert your mind to the caliber of men and women that were members of that conference, their pedigree, and the extent, the variety of subjects they covered, and that they were able to arrive at over 600 agreements consensually, shows that the report went beyond party coloration.
Yes.
To really assume the posture of a Pan-African, Pan-Nigerian report that can be relied upon for operation.
So you think this president should not ignore that report?
He should not ignore it, because it favors everybody in the sense that it will promote a better Nigeria. See, we have arrived at a situation that no use complaining about presidential system, because it works elsewhere.
Yes.
It's the operator that can make it work or make it fail. Form of government, all those things have worked elsewhere. We now have to improve on what we have. And study of these things will now ferret all those things that we must do to make these things work for us. So it's a report I will want the present administration to look into. And not wave it up because we are not the initiator
of it,
of the conference.
So let's look at the ministries that those nominees will be handling. The former governor of Ekiti State, Dr. Kai Adefaemi, has been assigned to the Solid Minerals Ministry. If we're thinking of diversifying our economy, a lot of people talk about solid minerals because they say there is no state in Nigeria that doesn't have some kind of natural resource that can be harvested.
Yes, Dr. Fayemi has shown over time as a serious person, focused person.
Yes.
He handles assignments given to him. And this solid mineral is one of the areas that can aid our diversification.
You think it's a round peg in a round hole?
Very much so. Because there's so much job to be done there. It has been left more or less virgin. All we've done before now is just skirting around the main thing. Dr. Fayemi can go much deeper. You see, it's as profitable as oil.
Yes.
Just that we are fixated with this rent collecting thing, because we know the oil is being done by other people. They pay royalty to us and all that. But this one will not only give us resources, it will give us jobs, will create jobs locally. And it's everywhere around the country.
There's no state that's not endowed.
So everybody will be engaged. As a matter of fact, it's one of the ways through which we can get out of poverty. It is needed now. It's just like solid mineral is one, agro-allied is another,
yes,
and manufacturing.
And for agriculture, we have Chifaudu Ogbe.
Very good man. He's been around for a very long time and has acquired knowledge and experience all over.
Yes.
You know, about 35 years ago, he was a minister. That's then of communication.
Yes.
And ever since, he's been a farmer in his Otupa, that's in Idoma, in Benue State. So he's not a newcomer who will come to receive tutorials on what agro-allied is.
Any surprise that Lai Mohammed is the Minister for Information?
Why should I be surprised? Check out the list.
Yes.
Has he a match for that portfolio? There's nobody that can rival him for that portfolio in that among the list. And whether you like him or not, you see, he had earned a name for himself in that field from this, because when he left the government of Lagos State to try to become governor of
Kwara, yes.
And this is the emergence of EC, had been their spokesperson, ECN their spokesperson, and which all metamorphosed into APC, had made a robust contribution by success of these positions. That when you talk of APC, and APC says something, the next name is Lai Mohammed.
Yes. It's the face of the party.
It's the face of the party. That's his job cut out for him. It's at home.
Yes. And the former governor of Lagos State, this to me seems loaded. Power, works, and housing, Babatunde Fashola.
Well, if the former governor, Babatunde Fashola, is not loaded, who will? I say this with all sense of responsibility. I know it from the distance, but I've met him closely firsthand with his work in Lagos. He turned Lagos around. Look at Oshodi. Greenery, roads. I went somewhere in Lagos, somewhere down Isolo. This construction I saw there, the bridges that opened up a virgin ghetto, and these were his works. One of the very few. Ghetto Lagos Island or most places. You think it's not the same Lagos that we all used to know. That is the work, the contribution he made to Lagos. So if he had that level of zeal and capacity to work in diverse areas
as a governor,
because governor is like jack of many trades. Mm. You are talking of water, you are talking of roads, you are talking of hospital, you are talking of courts, you are talking of
education.
If he had that presence of mind and that capacity to achieve much in a state like Lagos, that is so cosmopolitan, so urbanized, it's a mini Nigeria itself, that can achieve that, then having this kind of portfolio is not a surprise to me. I can say well ahead of time that they will deliver. Because even now, this is smaller. This has less distractions to the job of a governor.
It concentrates now on three areas.
More focused to give leadership. Like I think we once said that he's a lawyer. That's the only thing he can boast of. But as a governor, he built roads. There are some cadre of doctors in this town that they don't go on strike. He employed them specially with that condition.
Yes.
Don't embark on any strike. Somebody was involved, that's how I got to know that. Mm. So if he can be that detailed, then works, though the work there is enormous and massive, he can do a lot. But, and a big but, he has to open his eyes very well.
Why do you say he has to open his eyes very well and works?
Well, because the World Bank standard for road construction, for example, is about 238 million per kilometer.
Naira.
But in Nigeria, it costs us about 1 billion naira per kilometer. You can see the difference.
Yes.
That's one. Two, experts have recommended that in the southern part of Nigeria, particularly in the rain belt areas, roads should be constructed with concrete cement instead of the present asphalt that don't last. They are easily washed away. It's not a man you teach anything. I think he will know the challenges confronting him.
He will do his research.
Yeah, he will do his research and look into this. So that right now, so many roads are crying for attention. To enter Lagos, for example, from Onibada Express Road, it's like sometimes you think you are going to walk. Just where Lagos is within earshot, you still spend 2-3 hours before you can enter. Why? The roads are bad. Not only in Lagos, but Onitsha, Enugu is the same. Everywhere. These are areas about roads that he has to really hit the ground running. Because you talk of funds. The funds are not easily available because road constructions are expensive.
Yes.
In the current budget, only 100 billion naira was budgeted for roads. But when the problem of oil sales came in, it was reduced to 11 billion
for roads
maintenance. But how well those 11 billion was utilized, it's anybody's guess. Mm. So the next one is power, isn't it?
Yes, power, works, and housing.
Power, that speaks for itself. We're having problem with power. And without power, not many things can be done. Our life these days revolves about the availability of power. That's why I want to grant Pepe needs power. The barber needs power. The tailor designer, everybody needs power. Mm. To enjoy the comfort of your home, You need power to use your television. Not to talk of the major catalyst for development, which is industries,
yes,
manufacturing. Because apart from domain, you have to develop. Without power, you cannot manufacture. And if you must create jobs, you must improve the economy, you must develop social infrastructure, you need power. Housing, of course, the housing deficit in the country is massive. We all know that.
Yes, and, but he had done a lot in Lagos State with the homeownership mortgage scheme. Do you think that can be replicated at the federal level?
I think you will have to approach it differently. In the first place, apart from owning the houses are not just there. In a situation where 10,000 apply for homeownership and you get 50, it's a far cry. I think he has to do much more. Think of something more ingeniously creative.
And the former governor of Rivers State, Rotimi Amaechi, you know, many people were very curious when the first set of appointments came from the president, secretary to the government of the federation, chief of staff. He kept missing out on all that. But now he's the minister for transportation.
Well, before that was speculated whether the secretary or chief of staff and all that. It was rife and it was in the public domain. But
yes, even vice president in the early days.
Yeah, in the early days. But I think anybody who, a keen political observer, will know that that was far-fetched. You see, you can't get a vice president from that place when the rival to then candidate Buhari
was from the south.
Yes. Does not make good political judgment, in my opinion.
What about Dr. Chris Ngige, labor and employment?
Dr. Ngige, though trained a medical doctor, has been a governor with very turbulent reign.
Yes.
Very turbulent. And but he had managed to organize himself. He went to the Senate for a term. He had related extensively with human beings. This labor and
employment,
instead of dealing with people. If you have good relation, I think he has managed to maintain non-controversial image,
yes,
in spite of the turbulence he constantly finds himself. And I think he can bring that to bear on his new portfolio.
And we all expected, of course, Emmanuel Ibekachukwu would go to the Petroleum Ministry. He is the Minister of State for Petroleum. So
the title there, Minister of State, presupposes that there is going to be a higher minister. I don't know why the president has done this. He knows why. But whatever we are saying now, he knows why
he's doing it.
Yes. Person. He's a man who has been in the oil and gas sector from a multinational to a national corporation, NNPC, as a MDCEO.
Yes.
And now to have an added portfolio of Minister of State is a right peg in a right hole or square peg in a square hole. Mm. Whatever. It's right for the position. Yes. Does not need any tutorial to carry out his job.
And Amina Mohammed from the United Nations, she's posted to the Ministry of Environment. You know, she was overseeing the MDGs at the time, you know, working for the UN. So perhaps because of her exposure in the UN, you think the environment is the right place?
Yes. See, somehow we don't seem to appreciate enough the impact of environment here in Nigeria. So much is happening. We talk of environmental degradation, we talk of desert encroachment, we talk of a whole lot of things. Unless other things are loaded into that thing, I think we have enough to chew. But what that is, a much correlation between its MDGs, Millennium Development Goals, and this environment.
Yes.
They are not too distant apart, but they are certainly not quite the same.
Well, so all in all, we have the cabinet in place now. The ministers know where they are going. Some people may say it's 5 months too late. What will be your last words on this? What can we expect from this cabinet?
We expect that the president should make a very good use of them. Because his body language before now seemed to suggest that he has scant regard for ministers. He has scant regard for collegiate governance. And that he will not even give portfolios to all ministers. You need to rethink
that.
Because we are in a critical situation now that there is so much work to be done and all ministers must be engaged. That does not entail creating new ministries.
Yes.
But all ministers will be given jobs to do so that they can earn their pay and their allowances. You see, we are tired of one man show. We need this college of ministers to brainstorm at the cabinet meetings and brew ideas that will galvanize this country to a greater pedestal. So they should hit the ground running, and the president should take leadership, because without leadership, much will not be achieved.
Thank you very much, Mr. Agbo, for coming back on the program.
Thank you, my dear.
And thank you for watching. I'm Angela Ajetumobi.